Welcome to the Art of Living Big podcast. My name is Betsy Pake, and I'm an author, speaker, and a master mindset coach focused on helping you understand and design your life with the power of your subconscious. This podcast is designed to help you think differently about what could be possible for your life. Now, let's go live big. Hey, everyone. Welcome to the show today. So today I have on a guest who is a listener on the show. And I was in the Facebook group and I had posted something on Instagram about how I think everybody has like things to share and thoughts to share with the world. And anyway, I ended up posting it in my Facebook group. Allan ended up emailing me and I just felt like it would be a fun conversation, sort of like a co-host for the day. So I kind of like the idea of co-host. You know, people bring new ideas and different things that they're listening to or experiencing. And so I hope that you enjoy this conversation. It is just simply a conversation about all things woo and all things brain science. And we should talk a little, we share a little bit about podcasts and thought leaders and just kind of, we follow the path. So I hope that you enjoy. Come along with us. Hello, everyone. Welcome, adventurers. So, all right. So this is a little different. So I've got somebody on the phone. It's the mystery person. So inside my Facebook group, which if you're not there, you can go there by going to theartoflivingbig.com. So inside that Facebook group, about a week ago, I said something about like, you know, we all have a story, right? We all have something to share. And I was curious about other people's stories. And really, my intent of that post was I thought maybe people could send me like 2-minute things about what they wanted to share with the world. And then I would just post everybody's 2-minute things, right? So I'd do an episode with like what everybody had to share with the world and use the platform to share everybody's message. I thought that would be cool. And I oddly did not get very many responses, but I did get a response from Allan. And Allan Chuley's on the phone. Hey, Allan.
Hey, Betsy, how are you?
I'm good. Okay, so I dragged him on the show. I was like, I think you should come on and let's talk a little bit. And so I just thought it would be fun to have like a co-host. So welcome, co-host.
Thanks, Betsy. It's so cool to be here, actually. I'm honored for sure.
Yeah, like you've been listening to the show for a while. I feel like you've been in the Facebook group for a while, haven't you?
I have. Yeah, I was trying to look back. It's been at least a year.
Yeah.
I started getting into podcasts about 2 years ago, maybe a bit less. And then I found yours. I don't recall how, other than just looking for answers, really. And then one of the reasons I picked on yours was because it's called The Art of Living Big, which sounds cool. But being a musician, I was in a band. We wrote a song called Big Life, and it was about living a bigger life and what that meant to me at the time. Yeah. So that was one of the reasons that it's kind of got my attention with the title, and then just by listening to your voice and your energy and what you're talking about, it's weird. I found that the last year or two looking for things that when I when you start to look for one thing, all of a sudden another little thing appears, right? So a lot of episodes at the time and even since that you were talking about was like, I did honestly feel, and I'm not just saying this because I'm on the phone with you, but it felt like you were talking to me, and it's like something I needed to hear a little piece, you know, to start healing and move forward in my life.
Sure.
And so that's how it kind of started. So
that's cool. You know, I do think that there's power in sharing your story, and everybody has a story, right? And I think there's power in that because I don't know if it's social media or if it's, I don't even think it's social media. I'm going to take that back. I think it's just life. Yeah. Like we present ourselves to people in a way that separates us. Like it inherently separates us because we only show like the good stuff. Like even before social media, right? We'd show up at work and we would be like totally put together and you know what I mean? Like ready to act professional. And it separates us
totally.
because the truth is our stories are messy and, you know, full of ups and downs and we're only presenting one part. So yeah. So I love that you found sort of like a connection in that because I think everybody's story, we're all so similar, you know, but we create the separation.
For sure. And it's funny you said that because when left you the message with my idea. I was listening to a podcast of yours. I don't know if it was last week, week before, but you had talked about when you were younger and your daughter was really young and you were struggling and she was in daycare and you, like, money was an issue and a lot of struggles. And and it hit me because it very much reminded me of myself when my son Brady, who's 21 now, was a young boy, and our finances were horrible. And it kind of made me feel like, because people see how you are now, but they may have not seen how you were 10, 15 years ago.
Right.
And I thought, wow, like you seem like you've done so well. And I wouldn't expect that in one aspect. But then again, I realized, again, you don't see people's whole story like you're talking about, right? So you see someone who's successful or doing well. You don't see the shines of it. Led up to that, you know?
Well, yeah, right? And so lots of times... Yeah, and you don't see them until they're successful. So then you think, well, that's how it's always been, right? I remember when my daughter was little, and I don't think I've ever told this on the show. I don't think I told it on that episode, but she was little. I mean, you know, in that episode, I was talking about how exhausted and stressful. I was a single mom. I was having to get up at like the crack of dawn, bring her to daycare before school, which was like so freaking painful for me emotionally. And I remember I went to get gas. I had dropped her off and I had to get gas, which I remember being like, oh my God, am I going to have money for gas? Like, I go to get gas. And then I realized I had this fear that I was going to lock myself out of my car. Like, all the time I was thinking that I don't want to lock myself out of the car. And I went in and got my gas. I got my gas, pumped my gas, and I don't know, I went in to buy a bottle of water or something. And then I came out and I was like, oh my God, I've locked myself out of the car. And I was, what am I going to do? Like, I'm at the gas pump. Like, I went in and I looked around to see if I'd brought my keys in, you know, and left them on the counter. And I mean, I was like panicking. I'm going to be late for work. Like, what am I going to do? And so I asked the guy if I could call, who I would call. We looked it up in the phone book, you know? And after probably like 10 minutes of going back and forth and trying to get somebody out, he was like, what's in your hands? And I literally had the keys in my hand. But I was so focused on that I was going to lock myself out that I just assumed I did, because the door was locked when I went to get in, you know? And I just, I remember that so much. And it's such a, like, creating, your, talk about creating your reality, right? Like,
that's true.
So anyway, but those were rough times. Yeah. So you heard that and you're like, everybody's got like this story, but so many times we just see the highlight.
That's true. That's very true. And that would just seem to resonate with me a bit, because my son being when he was young, like, I mean, to be totally honest with you, I had to go to the food bank to get food because I couldn't afford to, you know, and I had to stand in line with a bunch of people. And it was a weird feeling because part of me felt really guilty because my parents always took care of things and that kind of thing. And the other aspect, I was grateful because at least there was something for me. So it was a really weird kind of, you know,
like
moment.
But at the time,
it was. And at the time, it felt like I am never going to get out of this. And that was like 2003, 2002. So a long time ago now. And, but yeah, it was, I have no idea how I'm going to do. I mean, I kind of want to, even at that point, I really was into the personal development and wanted to help people. I said, I can barely even take care of myself. How can I, and my son, how can I take care of other people, you know? So it was pretty, the only things at that point, to be honest with you, that kind of kept me going was my son, Brady, who was just a young little tyke at that point, and my guitar, my music was the only thing that gave me some sense of strength, I guess. The rest was like, it was overwhelming, to say the least, so.
So tell us a little bit about your journey then. What area of the country do you live in to start with?
I live in Calgary, Alberta. It's in kind of in the middle. Probably. I mean, it's in Western Canada. I'm from Regina, Saskatchewan, which is, you know, not too far from here, I guess. But I've been playing music forever. Guitar, writing music.
I need to hear that song, you know, That Big Life.
I don't know if I have it's an old version. I do have a website with some of my songs on it.
What is that? Give everybody your website.
It's just my name, AllanChuley.com.
Okay. I'll put a link.
You know, so I've been playing music forever, for a long time. Did that for quite a few years on the road, playing with some recording artists, but nothing of major, you know, probably no one you'd hear of, but it was still quite a cool experience.
Yeah, totally.
You know, and then in my 20s, I got into it was when I first started getting into the person development like this. Tony Robbins was my first, like a lot of people, I guess.
Yeah.
My first exposure to it.
Yeah.
And it took me, because I was probably like 23 maybe when I first heard of him. And it took me till I was 48 till I finally got to his event of his.
Yeah.
Oh,
was it?
For you.
Was it awesome?
It was actually, you know what, not to sound all cliche and melodramatic, but it was the start of my unpeeling, I guess, because at that point, that would be July of 2018 in Chicago, I went to UPW.
Okay, I'm going to Chicago to UPW in July this year.
And that's so bizarre.
Maria. Yeah. If anybody's listening and they're going, they need to come tell me so we can meet up.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, it is very cool. I guess the thing about that was that I been wanting to go forever, but before that is when I started, to be honest again, I started dealing with anxiety after my dad passed away.
Yeah.
And I think what it was a lot of the reality of mortality because both parents are gone. And all of a sudden I just started noticing all these weird, probably more on the health side of things, even though I take care of myself and I'm very health conscious, but it seemed like that seemed to be where my fear was, right? And then, so when I went to Tony Robbins, that's about 6 months into, 7 months, all of a sudden he's just, not panic attacks quite, but close enough. And then I went to that, and that was kind of the start of like, to unpeel everything and start to, you know, face some of my stuff. And it's not like I went there and then for 4 days and everything changed.
Yeah.
It's kind of a slow, gradual process, but that kind of led to getting into meditation, into a lot of things, the podcast, you know, now it's a whole bunch of other things. It's just every little thing. You probably had the same experience, but things before that I saw, but didn't really pay attention to, all of a sudden, stuck out. I was like, I have to get that book, or I have to try this, or I have to go there. And like Dr. Joe Dispenza was another one. That all of a sudden before I saw his book, Break the Habit of Being Yourself, it didn't really kind of resonate. But then all of a sudden I saw it, going, I need to get that book. And that was a big change for me too. So
it is like interesting, like when you get to the point where you're ready for stuff. I know I actually bought the book, Break the Habit of Being Yourself. I bought the audio version right when it came out.
Okay.
And I was like, what is this guy? And I returned it. Isn't that funny?
Oh, did you?
Yeah. Because, and I own the book now and I've read it, but like, it is true. Like, the teacher will come when you're ready, right? And I just wasn't ready for that.
Yeah. It is very true. And I mean, I've heard that before. And like, I guess it comes down to you can understand it, but there's a difference between, at least how I look at it, there's a difference between understanding something and knowing something, right? And
tell me,
it came
tell
to a point where it's like,
I want to know more about that. Understanding something and knowing something.
I guess because I'm a pretty feely type of person, meaning, you know, as far as I'm a musician, I guess, and a Pisces Aquarius cusp, so I don't know if I'm more sensitive, but I find that when I can be shown something or I'll see something and I'll notice it, right? Like, okay, there's a book. There's this. Yeah, that makes sense. You know, when you're ready, the teacher will appear.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's just all of a sudden, there's just like a knowing or like a feeling. Because I tend to, in terms of, for me, I have a gauge when I feel like I'm on to something that's meaningful to me and not just me pretending.
Yeah.
I get the goosebumps a lot. If I'm really excited or on my arms or anywhere, I'll just start getting goosebumps going, okay. And my belief is, for me, it's either my angel talking to me and saying, hey, Al, you're in the right path, or an inner knowing, or both, whatever it is. I just feel like when it's something that really resonates with me, either, you know, I have to face or something excites me, that's my body telling me, okay, you're in the right path. Stop listening to your mind, follow your heart more than, you know.
Yeah, I think that too. Yeah, I like that a lot. So when you think of like understanding, that's more cognitive, it sounds like. And when you think of knowing, you're talking about like intuition or knowing on a deeper level.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's almost like a no questioning it as opposed to like, well, yeah, maybe, oh, but, oh, God, okay, well, you know, because my parents were, well, my mom, I don't think she was psychic per se, but I think she could feel things and she was open to this kind of stuff. My dad, I mean, he was an awesome man, but he would just went by the stuff, he said, oh yeah, okay. Like, so I'm sure sometimes in my mind I would go, I really believe this, but what would my dad think, you know, or, well, you know, so, but if I just know it, I'm not thinking of that. I'm just, reacting to what I'm feeling as opposed to overthinking it,
right.
Which I can do a lot if I let myself.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, you know.
Yeah. So as you kind of started on this journey then, so tell me like what it sort of looked like what did your journey look like? So you started kind of going to Tony Robbins and having this experience that was, and really, you know, I think the Tony Robbins experience, is so all encompassing, right? It includes so much physical stuff, right? Because he has you, if anybody's that's listening, like if you've seen clips of it, or if you've been to Tony Robbins, you know what I'm talking about, but he does a lot of like where he'll play music. He'll have you put your hands up in the air, jump up and down. It is a state change that he creates constantly to get you into a hyper learning state. And so you feel, it's very emotional, right? And you feel a lot of things because you're doing that. When your body moves in that way, like your brain starts to change, right? So you went to that and you felt like that was really impactful. And then kind of what happened next? Or what was the big learning in that? Was there any big learning?
There was. I think what it was that the last 7-8 years, I was doing something different where it was really not emotionally attached in a good way. And I felt very, alone in a sense, I guess. I wasn't used, because as a teacher, I'd be talking to people all the time and being more outgoing, you know? Mm-hmm. So when I went there, all of a sudden, I kind of forgot how outgoing I can be in. Because I'm dancing and screaming and yelling with total strangers, hugging people. And like, I don't dance. Like, it's not my specialty, right? But I'm dancing, not caring, and then walking on fire. And I'm thinking, man, like, there's so much more to me than just being. I used to think of myself as a shy person. I thought, I'm not shy. Sometimes I just have nothing to say, you know? And so it kind of opened up that part of it. But you know what? I think how I viewed myself was not the real me, even though I've heard it said before by telling me, like, I can choose to be who I want to be, right? Because I do have parents who, they're still here in one form or another, but they were very play it safe kind of personalities, which is fine. But I mean, I think that's why I got longer hair, tattoos, played loud guitar, because I wanted to be different. And I like being different. Yeah. And I like people who are different and stuff, right?
Yeah.
So that started opening up that. And then I just started opening up stuff, you know, unconsciously. I probably kept at bay for a long, long time. And my MO was afraid of confrontation. So I think I was running away from a lot of things I was afraid of or ashamed of. But as I've come to realize, I can run away, but it finds me eventually, right?
Right.
And I started, like I said, the anxiety got worse. But it was never like to a point I couldn't live. Just it was uncomfortable and scary. So I started saying, no, I want to figure out what's going on. And then that led to, like I said, like Joe Dispenza. I got into meditation a lot. And I just started to unearth my stuff, right?
Yeah.
And then face it as opposed to running away. And I noticed with anxiety, let's say, I started feeling fearful. If I just sat there and just wait a minute, just experience it and not get emotionally involved, it started to go away.
Ah, yeah. So when you and could then, just be with it. Yes.
Yeah. And then what it's done is, I've heard this said before, like the phrase, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. And it comes back to the knowing. It's because I can understand that on the a conscious level, but when you know it, and what I realized is that all this health stuff, I was feeling like being afraid of dying, basically, is that it opened up so many more things to me that I know now that I would have never even been into. Right.
And
it made me get my blood checked to get for food sensitivity. So now I eat even healthier for my particular body, whatever. So it's really been a gift, to be honest with you.
So it's really just, it kind of sent you on a journey, right? And as you uncovered more. Yeah.
So, it's weird because go ahead.
No, you go.
Well, I was just going to say last year was weird. It seems like I'm really starting to believe more in divine timing. And last year with work was quite slow. So I had a lot of time at home to just kind of think and work on myself. And then as the end of this past year came in, it got really busy. So it allowed me money to invest in myself a bit, which is what my goal was this year was to, you know, last year was about healing myself and growing. And my goal is for this year to try and help heal others. You know, and because even at work, I'll talk to people and I just seem to be able to understand, you know, like what may, why they might may feel the way they do, you know, badly, or can help them with, you know, nutritional stuff, whatever. Mm-hmm. But it has been quite a, it's allowed me, again, like I said, this year, I wanted to invest in myself health-wise.
Yeah.
All kind of ways, right?
Yeah. So, yeah.
But it's been a gift. Otherwise, a lot of the stuff I wouldn't have even thought of, to be honest with you.
Tell me, on this journey, have there been any books in particular that you've read that had a huge impact on you?
Yeah, books and a few people. Well, the book I said, the probably that Dr. Joe Dispenza, because I saw it about 2 years ago. Like when you go, if you use the Kindle app, you can like sample books and stuff.
Yeah.
And it's weird because I had that book on there. I think it gives you two chapters or something.
Right, yeah.
But then last year around, I'd say June, I'm a big fan of Motley Crue, so I followed Nikki Sixx. And on his Instagram page, he put a picture of the book, his hand, and he said, "Game Changer." I thought, you know what? I forget that book. And then I couldn't get it out of my head.
Was it the Soup Becoming Supernatural or the other one?
Breaking
the Habit.
Of books, actually. Yeah, it was that one. And then I went through the 4-week kind of process in the book. I did it longer than 4 weeks, but
yeah.
But that's where all of a sudden I started gaining a bit of.
Have you read the Evolve Your Brain? I think that's what the other one is called.
I do have it, but I kind of started, but didn't get as much into it yet. But
yeah.
I sometimes find I'll read a book a bit and nod and then come back when I'm ready. Or
oh my God, I do this all the time. I start books and then I'm like, okay, I'm done. And I move on to another one. That is like one of the things that drives me nuts about myself. I would like to finish. Like when I finish a book, it's a celebration. I get bored or something. I don't know. I have so many things I want to learn.
Me too. I think that for me, it's like if I'm reading it for a bit, I'm thinking, man, I'm only half into it. I'm thinking, no, I mean, I could read it, but I'm not going to get much out of it. I'll come back when I'm called to read it.
Yes.
I feel like, you know, and then I do. So, I mean, that, I've been doing a bit of Bob Proctor, if you know who Bob Proctor is.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Yeah.
Doing the paradigm stuff. Okay. And then just a few people I've met, even in Calgary, and people I've just met who just seem to have a lot of knowledge that seems to say something that I need to hear at the time. And I've just been really I did do a little bit of because I'm you know counseling with the spiritual counselor, which is kind of a cool little bonus. And so again, it was part of the journey through that. Now I about 3 months ago I did it, and I've been journaling every day ever since. And it just adds to what I do to, you know, grow myself and deal with stuff. And I don't know, it's weird because I had a few people who know me pretty well, and I see them and they'll look at me and they say, "Man, you seem so," I've always been very patient and calm individual, but they say, "Man, you just seem different," like in a good way, not like,
yeah.
So it's having an impact on me that
I
always noticed that.
Yeah. And I feel like in the group, like you've shown up as like, seeming to me, it seems like you're very thoughtful, like you're thinking through things and like have deep thoughts, which is why I thought it would be fun to have you on the show. But it seems like there are like deeper thoughts underneath there, you know? And so I could definitely tell that you'd been like on the journey, you know, learning as much as you could, reading and all of that. Tell me, although The Art of Living Big is probably your favorite, but like, what are some other good, good, right answer. That's correct answer. But what are some other podcasts that you really enjoy? Because I like listening to podcasts. I have a lot I really like.
I do have a lot too. My main focus with them is either the personal development or like the health side of things or the woo-woo stuff. Like there's a lady named Ashley Wood, I think her name is, called Align
Manifest This?
Right, yeah, that one. So I listen to that sometimes.
Yep.
A lot of, there's weird because there's one today I was listening to Drew Pruitt. It's called A Broken Brain, or The Broken Brain Podcast. He works with Mark Hyman. And his podcast today was ironically enough about purpose, right? I said, oh, hang on.
Yeah.
So I just listened to that and I thought, what's kind of ironic? And then he was talking about purpose and people finding that they have to have their purpose. And he says, I don't even know what my purpose is. But he still does this amazing podcast. And so it kind of made me think, you know, sometimes finding your purpose doesn't mean you actually know exactly 100% what it is, but you're searching for something more, right? And something that resonates more with you. So his a lot. And then just like I think Dave Asprey is quite cool. And he's
all his experiments.
He's kind of like he reminds me sort of that doc from Back to the Future.
Oh, yeah.
Minus the weird hair. Like,
yeah. If anybody's listening, Dave Asprey, he's the one that made the Bulletproof Coffee thing, right? He owns that. But what's the name of his podcast? Is it just the Dave Asprey Show?
No, it's actually Bulletproof Radio, I believe it's called.
Oh, Bulletproof. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So things like that. There's a whole bunch, but the ones that probably would be more Mark Hyman one, health stuff. It's more in that vein for sure. I do it in yours quite often.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yep.
No, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I like Mark Hyman. He has a really good Instagram too, where he shares important things, I think.
Yeah.
Brain science stuff.
It is, yeah. He tends to go to, because I saw him in Chicago at UPW. Him and Wim Hof are both there, which was like far out.
So have you looked into Wim Hof stuff?
Actually, that's one of the things I forgot to list now. I started doing his stuff about a year ago.
If anybody's listening, let's kind of I feel like we're talking about a lot of things, but maybe if people don't know what they are, I just want to make sure they know. So if they want to look into it. So Wim Hof is a guy who is what they call him, the Iceman. And he talks about like brain control. So you're controlling your emotions to the point that you can go into like freezing cold water and stay there. And like your brain is fine, right? Because typically people would be freaking out, right? Hyperventilating. Yeah. But he teaches a breathing technique, and then he has like weekend retreats where he teaches you the breathing technique, and then you go, and you know what else? And then you go into ice water, right? But on The Goop Lab, have you watched that yet on Netflix?
I've heard of it, but no, I have not.
It's good because it's all this kind of stuff, you know? But they do all these different experiments, and they spend a weekend with Wim Hof. That's one of the episodes. So if anyone's interested. I was just going to say, I hate the cold. Like, I hate the cold. It makes me super angry to the point where I think I'm like, I think there's an anchor to being really cold when my mom died when I was young. That's the only thing probably. My husband and I have talked about it. And I'm like, that's the only thing I can think, because like I get where when it gets cold, I'm just so annoyed. Do you know what I mean? Like, to a point where it doesn't make sense, but I want to do the Wim Hof. Well, I live in Atlanta. And so, I mean, it gets cold here and I'm annoyed. Do you know what I mean? So imagine when I grew up and my mom died, I was in Vermont and it was March. And so I think that I was, you know, I was cold. I just remember standing outside waiting for everybody and being like, we've got to go because I got to figure out what's happening with my mom. Like, I knew she had been in an accident. And waiting outside, and I remember my coat and looking down and seeing my coat was unzipped. I remember the coat. It was like this really cool blue, light blue, dark blue, sort of like an ombre thing. And I looked down and I remember seeing that my coat was unzipped, but I didn't care. I just wanted everybody to hurry up so we could go and see what was going on with my mom, because she was traveling. So we had to go to where she was. And so I think that must have anchored for me. That's all I can think of, because I hate it so much.
I would assume that with the cold and with the anchor, what happened to your mother, unfortunately, there's a lot of pain linked to the things that were around you at the time, right?
Yeah, and not being in control.
So,
do you know what I mean? So like when it gets cold, I'm like, oh my God, I hate the can't stand this.
That's true.
And so as soon as I graduated from college, I moved from Vermont, but now I live in Atlanta. But even in Atlanta, like it gets, you know, if it gets, it'll get in the 30s. I mean, the 50s are enough to make me annoyed. It's sort of odd. When we went to Key West, I go off on a tangent, but when we went to Key West last year, it was like August and it was so hot. Yeah. Like my husband was like, I've never experienced hot like this before. It's like being in Satan's butt crack. Do you know what I mean? It's so hot.
Yeah.
And I was like, I love it. Like I loved it. Like I was like just sweating. I was like, give me a sweatshirt. So anyway, all of that.
Oh, wow.
All of that to say, I think that it's a trigger, and I probably could shift that using some NLP, but I don't know. It's sort of my personality now, so I like it.
Do you know much about Wim Hof's story, though?
No. Okay. Tell me, because it's like his family died, or his mom or his wife died or something, right?
No, it was, I mean, the thing that caught my attention was that he was, I think, I want to say it was the mid-90s, I think, and his wife had some kind of brain health. I hate saying actually mental health, like more like a brain health issue, and was, I don't know if she was bipolar or whatever it was, but she was on standard, you know, kind of medication and treatment. And then he just said that one day she just got up, kissed the kids, I think him, and jumped off the roof of a building, right?
Oh, yeah.
And then through his pain, and I remember him saying in an interview of a podcast, actually, that he, because where he's from, there's lots of this water around. He jumped into a river that was like a thin layer of ice, and he just found, I think, some peace in the cold, and then just started, probably, I guess, with, I mean, I'm not comparing my story to his by any means, but just by something happening, it kind of pushes you in a direction to start learning things you may have not learned before, right?
Well, yeah, and no growth happens if you're not in some kind of uncomfortable or pain, right? Because otherwise you just stay where you are. Yeah.
Oh, totally. Yeah, and I guess, I don't know. So I found his technique was another little tool for me that I still, even to this day, I don't always do the cold shower thing, but when I'm meditating, I'll do about 3 rounds of the breath holding and that kind of stuff, plus a bunch of other things, but to work on the breathing and that kind of thing. So again, he's another person that, and then seeing him a person, I had no idea who he was, but his personality as well was so quirky, I just loved it. Like, it's not like a typical, and he's done stuff besides with his immune system and all that, just like, and I think what I was going to say is that, like, with what I was feeling, my anxiety and stuff was, because I kind of forgot that I have a choice, meaning that in terms of health, I think some people feel that, well, you either get cancer or you don't. And I do know sometimes it's unfortunate bad things happen, but I can't, I mean, there's certain things I do have control over. You know, I do have control of what I eat, how I think, if I work out or I don't, if I drink or I don't. And that's where I think I started getting, for me, fearful that I felt like I had no choice. It's like, well, it's going to happen or it's not, as opposed to like, well, hang on, maybe I do have a choice here.
Right, right.
To learn things, right? And with anything in life, whether it's even going for goals, I mean, I'm not sure at what point you decided to, I don't recall what you were doing before you did the podcast, or even how long you've been doing it, to be honest with you, but I'm not sure what propelled you to go from doing what you're doing to what you are now, but there's something that obviously you realized you wanted to make a different choice in your life, right?
Right. Yeah. You can listen to episode number 1 and find out more.
Okay. Okay.
You got to go into the way back machine. Yeah.
Okay. No, I will do that for sure. But I mean, yeah, that's the thing, is a choice. And with some people I know that, like, I take my health very seriously. Mm-hmm. And I just feel some people who I grew up with, and it's not because I'm afraid of being old. I just want to grow young, right? I saw my dad before he passed away, who was so frail, and I felt so bad for him.
Right.
But he could have been, you know, but it was choices he made. And
sure, yeah.
Made it harder for him, right? And so I just want to give people, hopefully, like, again, I'm not sure where my path's going. I know that it's changing and I want to do things, but it's just like, I just want to give myself more choices, but make people realize that you do have a choice, even if it's difficult at times. Obviously, it was difficult for you when your daughter was young and you were trying to, you know, get your life together, but you had the choice either to say, well, this is the best I'm going to get, or I can say, you know what, even though it seems illogical maybe, but I want to do this. And
so yeah. And, you know, one of the things you were saying, well, we were talking earlier sort of about purpose, right? We touched on that. And now as you're talking, you know, I think our purpose, like I know what my like goal is, like what I would like to have in my future, but I don't know that that's my purpose. I think my purpose right now is to grow in this moment. So if somebody says to me like, what, I don't know what my purpose is. Well, it's to grow through whatever you're in. Like my purpose is constantly evolving as I am constantly evolving. But my purpose is always growth, right? So how can I grow? Whatever, if I feel stuck or if I'm having a horrible experience or I'm having a great experience, like how can I grow through this? And, you know, I know for me, like if it's something crappy happening, which, like everyone else listening, like I've had my share of crappy. So I think, like, what can I grow? What can be good about this? Like, how can I use this to help me? And then when something's good is happening, I think, how can I bring other people into this? Right? So, like, how can other people join me in the good? Yeah.
Yeah, no, I agree with you a lot, for sure. I mean, I'm not sure if I was to describe my purpose. I mean, I know the areas I'm drawn to, so I know it's where it is, kind of, sort of. But in terms of labeling it, I don't know if I really want to do that necessarily, because it is kind of a moving
thing. Yeah, like moving.
I think the theme is all very similar, but I mean, it sounds kind of corny when I say this, but I think one of my purposes, or at least ambitions or desires, to make people smile. And it sounds kind of corny, but
no, I love
when
that.
I'm with people, I like to make, well, even when I'm with the people, I like to make them laugh, even if it's at my own expense, you know, or if they're feeling down, help them, or if it's their health stuff. So, and, you know, at a basic level, a smile, you know, when you really just, it's a sincere one, it feels good because you're being true, I think, to who you are. And, you know, it's, you know, corny or not, I think it's, people are definitely more happier when they're smiling. It just, you know, if you're laughing in a movie or a sitcom or something funny, it's world, like, your life is good at that moment, right?
Right, right, so, sure. Yeah, well, it's when you're really in the moment, right? And so
I suppose that's true, because I haven't read the book, I have it, but The Power of Now.
Oh, yeah.
And I know the idea of it, obviously, is, and I was told before, in terms of anxiety, actually, is half the problem is there is you're worried about the future, or you're locked in the past, but you're not right here, right now. And one of the things they would say is just focus on something right now. Don't worry about what's going to happen 5 minutes from now or what happened when you're a 10. Just right now, and it kind of calms your nervous system back down to focus on one thing. And there's a lot of truth in it. I haven't really read the book, but
it's one of those ones
I should probably get to.
Yeah, I know. I have a big old list, but that one's a good one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, awesome. So, this was so good to have you on. Thank you for coming and just chit-chatting. It was kind of fun having a co-host and just talking about all of the things as it came up. So this was really fun. Thank you so much. Yeah, thank you so much for being here, Allan.
Oh, no, it's awesome, Betsy. I really appreciate being on here, and it's so cool that you got me on. It was very unexpected, and it's been so cool. Thank you so much.
Yeah, so fun. All right. We'll see you all next week. Thanks so much for listening today. Just a reminder, we'll see you on Mondays and Thursdays. Now, if you enjoyed this show, I would love it if you shared it with your friends. If you want to take a moment to leave us a review on iTunes, take a quick screenshot before you hit submit and email it over to us at support@betsypake.com, and we will send you a special audio hypnosis to help you overcome a limiting belief. Thanks so much, and I'll see you next week.